Live. We're back again. Welcome to Apple Music, and welcome to All I Have to Give Radio.
With the Backstreet Boys.
What?
Kevin, yeah, boys.
That's Kevin Richardson. That's Howard Duroe. We got AJ McLean. We got
Nick Carter.
And we got myself, Brian Littrell. Yes, and we are the Voltron of the Backstreet Boys. And this is All I Have to Give Radio, where you are going to hear some of the songs that influenced us as artists growing up. We've almost got 3 decades in music history, you guys. So we've got a lot to share. I don't know if the shows or the episodes are going to be long enough, but this is going to be so much fun. We are so excited. This is the first time that we've ever had a chance to do this with Apple Music. And it's like, I mean, how fun is this? Because we as artists, we get to like play songs that we love. We get to play songs that the fans want to hear. Okay, that's good. So you're going to hear a lot of Backstreet Boys songs, but you're also going to hear a lot of songs that influenced us as artists, because what you're going to find are 5 completely individual artists on this round robin. So let's get started. AJ,
I have one question.
You guys stop interrupting me. I am the star of this show.
Have you been lifting a lot of weights? Because your arms look swole right now.
You look swole, dog.
He got that swole, man.
He got that quarantine swole.
Hey, you know what it's called? Listen, you know what it's called? It's called downlight. That's what it's called. It's called downlight.
Oh, you got the you brought the studio lights in for this one?
Yes. It's called ambience. Hey, so fellas, obviously we've all been on that teen life.
Yeah, right.
You know, obviously I know for me, I've been listening to a lot more music that I don't normally listen to. Like when things are kind of normal and I'm just driving around in my car, or I'm going to my studio, or I'm taking the girls to school. Like I've been listening to a lot more new stuff than I didn't think I would even like. But what have you guys been listening to? Like anything new or old? Or are you guys on any like brand new artists right now?
I gotta be honest, like the thing that's making it hard, you know, because obviously I have a 7-month-old and a little 4-year-old. I mean, we all got kids, but one thing that's making it hard is that when you wake up, you know, the first thing you're doing is like, you know, the whole routine, whether it's like you're feeding, you know, you're doing all these different things. The first thing that happens is you put on TV. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So you put on like the Apple TV and you're going through all the different TV, the movies and stuff that are coming out. And mainly the stuff that I haven't necessarily been listening to radio as much as I should, but I'm getting actually a lot of really current music through movies, like, you know, like the Sonic movie. I got some cool music through that movie I've been listening to with the kids. The new Trolls movie. I don't know if you guys seen it.
Yes, I've seen it so many times.
Yo, did you guys see us show me the meeting on Scooby-Doo, the new Scooby-Doo?
Yeah, dude, Scooby-Doo, yeah.
That's all cool. Cartoon stuff.
I was like,
I saw you tweeted or Instagram that.
I was watching it. I was like, oh, my smokes. I'm like, the kids all went crazy.
I know. I was outside cleaning stuff out of the pool, and Rochelle was like, babe, come in here really quick. I'm like, what? She goes, just watch. And I'm watching the first, 10 minutes of Scooby-Doo, and I'm like, well, that's new. I don't remember management or anyone telling us, hey, this song's going to be in the movie.
Licensed. I'm like, wait a minute.
I was like, okay.
Quarantine surprise.
I'll tell you, though, man. Like, see, you guys don't have to worry about, I mean, Nick, you do, but not really yet, about having girls. I have 2 girls. So, like, right now it's all about boys. Everything is boys, boys, boys. So, like, Jonas Brothers, What a Man Gotta Do has been on repeat. No other song has been played in my house.
What a man gotta do.
Totally at the man you.
Hey, if you, my kids like the don't stay away too long, don't go to bed. I'll make a cup of coffee for your head. It's called,
who is this?
Now, it's Paul Fu, and the song is called Deathbed. I just thought the melody was so sweet, and we were listening to it, and then a couple of Max's and Mason's friends, they were gaming with them. They're like, you know that song's about dying, and now Max won't listen to it because it freaks him out.
That's
but,
funny.
Yeah, that song's called Deathbed, but it's got such a sweet little melody.
Oh, my gosh. Deathbed. That sounds like a great title.
Yeah. I also like the Harry Styles song.
I was about to say that.
Adore you. Man.
That's good.
It's got like an 80s vibe. That young man is doing it right. He's killing it.
That one and his new one, Watermelon Sugar.
Watermelon Sugar, hi. Watermelon Sugar. Hi.
The video's dope.
I don't think people realize that Backstreet Boys has such an eclectic sort of taste of music, like each individual person. And I don't think that we could just like commit to one, listening to one thing at any given time. You know what I mean? It's like that's
our DNA.
Okay, well, with that being said, let's get to the round robins part of the show, okay? We're going to have different segments of the show. We're going to have call-out responses. We're going to be talking to fans directly. But let's get to the round robin where each five of us get to pick a song that we've been listening to lately because everybody's been kind of tied up, you know, in their house with their kids. So I'm going to go to you, Howie. Howie, you go first. You play a song right now that you've been listening to with your family.
You know, I was thinking about this earlier, of like a song that's really been playing on my mind, especially during this quarantine time. And I have to go with what Kevin said. That Harry Styles song, Adore You, is just got a catchy melody that won't stop.
All right, let's play it. Here we go. On All I Have to Give Radio on Apple Music. Woohoo.
Kids.
All right, so we're going through the round robin section. Howie just played Just Let Me Adore You. Oh, honey, I love that song. Hey, Kevy Kev, you pick a song now. Round robin section. Here we go.
So I'm taking it to Missy Elliott. I can't stand the rain.
Ah.
We used to run into to Missy, we used to run into Genuine, we used to run into Timbaland, all those guys. Remember at, was it Alley Cat Studios? Aaliyah used to be there with us. Fatima was always, you know.
Choreographing all those music videos with all those artists, yeah. So yeah, Fatima was our choreographer. Of course, 90s hip hop, oh my God. 90s hip hop and R&B, it's the best. It's the best.
It is.
And so that's why I chose the Missy Elliott. And, of course, that was produced by Timbaland, who ruled the 90s.
Ah.
Me, I'm super fly, super duper fly, super duper fly.
As we were talking earlier about the 90s hip hop, it's so influential because, I think some of the best music, I agree with you, Kevin, like some of the best music was in the 90s, and it didn't have to always be pop. It was, you had Britney Spears, you had NSYNC, you had the Jive family, you had R. Kelly, you had Teddy Riley, Timberland. I mean, the list goes on and on.
You had Death Row, Bad Boy, you had...
I think we lost Nick.
You hear me? No, seriously, I was like, so Lauren had this, okay, let's just go into my favorite song right now. Look, check this out.
Come here. Okay, nice segue, bro.
Look. Whoa. Okay, so
whoa.
You're going to appreciate this.
What?
Hell
so,
yeah.
Mommy is getting ready to make him. What are you going to look like? Sonic the Hedgehog.
Nice. Awesome. What's up, brother?
I like it. Got to cut it a little bit and everything.
That's what else. Awesome.
Okay. He'll be back. He'll look like Sonic in a second.
What's up, buddy? I love your hair.
Anyways.
Blue. I'm out
we didn't even plan
right
that
now.
She was going to do his hair blue. And the reason why, because literally Hedgehog with Jim Carrey is on, like, repeat on every single day in the house. And he loves it. And AJ, you were the one that told me about it. You were like, dude, you got to go and see this movie.
Dude,
it really rocked. It was, like, amazing. And I'm like, all right, is it going to be one of those, like, failed, like, video game movies? And then
dude,
not only made a killing, but the music, I think, was what really set the movie off.
Yeah.
And so that leads me into this song that's like basically Odin's favorite song right now. It's the song by Wiz Khalifa. It's called Speed Me Up. And they actually took in the music video. So it's played at the end of the movie. In the music video, they basically turned Wiz and all the other rappers into like cartoon characters. And they're going through the game. And they're like playing the game. And then they have Carrie flying in as Dr. Robotnik. And it's hilarious. But this is like on repeat. It's called Speed Me Up. It's dope. And it has like all these like little 80s like sounds in it. Have you guys heard it?
Nope.
It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing.
I have. It's dope.
That's cool.
It's dope. It's a really, actually a really, really super well done film. And yeah, the soundtrack's dope.
Let my heart and my soul, you see that I read, brings up gold in the war.
Apple Music Hits. This
This is all I have to give radio with the Backstreet Boys.
When I'm home, my girls are obsessed with the Jonas Brothers right now and pretty much anything that Zac Efron touches. But when we were in Rio recently and we were chilling out, laying out at the pool, just trying to get some R&R, that particular hotel was playing some really dope music, and I had never heard any of these artists, so I Shazammed one, and I became a really massive fan of this dude, Rex Orange County. But it's just a chill. He said, loving is easy, and you got me effed up. It's about me. Loving
is
easy. It's so good.
AJ, stop singing it. Listen, people have to listen to All I Have to Give Radio on Apple Music, and they'll be able to hear it, right?
That is very true.
Loving is easy. You have me. It used to be so hard.
So, I do have a nice small pool at my house, and I've got a high school graduate, okay? My son has been introducing me to some John Mayer stuff, okay? I've always liked John Mayer, but I played you guys a song in South America. It's called Still Feel Like Your Man. It's like...
so good.
This dude...
Man, I love that song.
You know, and I don't know if you guys remember, we met John Mayer at a studio in
Westlake
LA.
Westlake Studios,
that's right. Yep. It's right under 405, right?
You and I were up in the front playing Pong, and he walked in.
Yeah.
A tall dude, man.
Dude, and he jumps, remember AJ, he jumped in his Audi A8 and he left because that was the brand new car then. We were like, what kind of car? Dude, I don't know. It seemed like it was a long time ago.
Early 2000 or late 90s?
No, we'd have to do some research.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'd have to do some research.
Kevin, you and I saw him one time.
Didn't we see him at the Playboy Mansion?
I think that's where it was.
It was a Halloween party at the Playboy Mansion, and Howie was dressed like AJ. And everybody thought he was AJ.
Oh, my God.
You got it good.
He had the beard drawn on and everything and a pair of pantyhose around the top of his head.
AJ was supposed to dress up as me, and he bailed out and didn't go.
Yeah, sorry about that, bro.
And who was Pamela Anderson dating at the time? Mark Schenkenberg?
Mark Schenkenberg, yeah.
Yeah, that male model. And you were talking to Pam as Howie, and she knew you were Howie, but Mark thought you were AJ.
Yeah,
he's like, hey, man. The hell? He thought AJ was trying to cut in.
Yeah. Trying to get me in some deep doo-doo, dude, and I wasn't even
and
there.
And the funny thing was is that we met the two of them back at the World Music Awards in Monte Carlo. I actually remember introducing the two of them, but he totally didn't recognize me. He thought it was AJ.
But wait. Let me ask the underlying question here, okay? Between Howie and AJ, why were you trying to go as each other? Why is this a
we just tried to be something funny.
No, AJ wasn't there.
It's not. No, listen. The reason you guys were going to go as each other is because everywhere you guys go in public for years, what happens?
Everybody thinks I'm Howie, and I don't know how the hell.
I think you were right about that.
That's what I'm saying.
He is right. Like, how the hell is it possible? We look nothing alike. With the exception that we're both Latino, no. You've never had a beard like this, tattoos, you have a full head of hair, I sure the hell don't. You got a full old head of, yeah.
Better looking.
Exactly.
Better looking.
Okay,
good.
Wow.
I still feel like a man.
Oh. Have to give radio with the Backstreet Boys.
Apple Music. You know, obviously, what, like 28 years, going on 28 years now, we've been around for a little while. When did we start? Brian, you're the guy that always remembers the exact date. When did we first start the Backstreet Boys?
We started the Backstreet Boys on April 20th, 1993.
That's when Brian showed up.
That's when the real Backstreet Boys started.
Yeah, the real Backstreet Boys. Yeah.
Now, but the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, it took what? Like, from that moment that we met Brian, 3-4 years before we actually got our first record deal, right? And then that's when we met Jive Records. And along with Clive Calder, who was sort of the mastermind behind it all, the president of the label, he had the idea, along with us, to send us over to Sweden to start recording with a producer and two producers and writers, Max Martin and Dennis Popp at the time. Dennis Popp had just come off of some big success with a band that everyone knew at the time in the late 90s, Ace of Base.
Yep. I saw the sign, and it opened up.
That's some really unique music, you know. There was them, there was, you probably wouldn't know E-Type.
Robin.
Or, you know, Robin was another one who actually broke in the States. So it was really Robin and Ace of Base who took Dennis Pop's sound along with this new protege of Dennis Pop. Dennis Pop was a producer. And he had Max Martin, who was the top line writer, and they started kind of like partnering up, and things kind of started growing for them. And that's when it caught the attention of Jive and sent us over there. And I don't know how long we took when we were recording the music, maybe like a couple years, you know, and we were collecting songs as time was going on. But that first record, the Backstreet Boys record, was a combination of two records, essentially. One that was released in Europe first.
Because it was half of, it was like pieces from the Red Album.
Yeah.
We'll call it the Red Album, and then new stuff. Yeah. Or new stuff then.
So we took, basically, we had this album that we had released, but before we released that Red Album, we took a chance and tried to put a song out in the States. We've Got It Going On. Yep. This was around the time that Snoop Dogg, it was massive. It had just come off of his Doggy Style record and Nirvana, and basically it was grunge and it was rap and a little bit of dance music. And this song, We've Got It Going On, was, we thought it was really great, and we thought it could, you know, it had a shot. It had a little bit, I'd like to say it had almost like a Bobby Brown-esque kind of feel to it, right, Kevin?
Mm-hmm.
What did you say?
Yeah, it had that dirty, funky, it had some grit to it, some bravado, some balls.
New Jack Swing.
We thought it was great. We thought it was an opportunity to break, but we released it, and it flopped.
It tanked.
And the tank.
It tanked.
Like, what, number 60?
69 on the dance charts in 1995.
Ooh-wee.
1995. Then we went where the demand was. It was getting airplay in Germany. So we went there. Our manager at the time, Johnny Wright, had a lot of relationships there with
Turbo B from Snap.
I got the power.
So did he do rhythm is a dance?
It's getting kind of hectic. So we went over there to promote it, and we show up at this big arena. It's a big radio show. We go out on stage
in Nuremberg,
and people lose their minds.
Popcorn Festival.
We were supposed to go there for just that performance. We ended up staying for almost a month promoting the song because it did so well.
We called it Germany, Austria, Switzerland. We went over there. They opened up their hearts for us, and we were able to stay over there and tour. And we took this album at the time called The Red Album. And then we decided, I think once we got, I think it was Backstreet's Back, Everybody Backstreet's Back. We got Quit Playing Games With My Heart. And then we had, I think, As Long As You Love Me, Brian, as well. That was on that record.
Backstreet's Back came after the Red Album.
Yeah.
Because we weren't back yet.
No, but what I'm saying is that we got those songs from being over there as we were recording and touring, and then from the Red Album, we were able to take these new songs, combine them, and then we started to launch into the States.
Yeah.
And that's the first Backstreet Boy album, which then leads me into, I think, the song that didn't have a shot, and we felt was a hit. We perform it still today in our show. It's We've Got It Going On. So this was basically the first Backstreet Boys song.
Everybody grew to the music. Everybody jam. We've got it going on.
All right, cool. Well, you know, you got the Red Album, and then, as we were just talking about Backstreet Boys versus Backstreet's Back, the official U.S., first U.S. album had the song Backstreet's Back on it, because, you know, it was our second album, but it was our first official album in the U.S. So it was kind of an oxymoron if you think about it, because it was our first album, but we weren't really back in the U.S. but we were back everywhere else in the world. So Backstreet's Back off that album was, I mean, that was our first MTV VMA award that we won. You know, I'll never forget, we did a bulk of videos, if you guys remember, during that time. We shot All I Have to Give, As Long as You Love Me, and Backstreet's Back.
Yep.
All within like a month. Yep.
It was like two or three weeks.
Yeah, yeah. Backstreet's Back took 3 days because they built that set from the ground up.
Yeah.
Joseph Kahn did Backstreet's Back. That was our first time working with Joseph. Nigel Dick did As Long as You Love Me and both, right? All I Have to Give as well. Yeah.
Yes.
I think so. Sure. Yeah. You're talking about the evolution. We're all talking about the evolution of us, the Backstreet Boys, right? On All I Have to Give Radio. But the cool thing about what Nick was saying, when he was talking about the Germany, Austria, Switzerland territories in Europe, you know, this is really the reason a lot of fans don't know that we ended up blowing up in France. Right after that, we blew up in France. Then it bled all the way through to the UK. And then it went all the way to Montreal in Canada, in Quebec, Canada, which is the French-speaking province of Canada. Comment ça va, Fabien? Yeah. So when it blew up in Montreal, it bled all the way to Vancouver in Canada. So then, this is 1996, 97.
96.
Late 96, because we were, you know, because like Nick said, when we were traveling over there, we were also recording. So we weren't stopping, you know. A lot of people were like, oh, you travel around. We keep driving the ship. So it bled all the way to Vancouver, and then in Buffalo, New York, in North Dakota, South Dakota, Chicago, Toronto, all of these radio stations in the U.S. that you could pick up, Canadian radio stations at that time, were playing a little song called Quit Playing Games in My Heart.
Yep.
And so the rest is history. So now, AJ, you can continue on with your VMA stories and all that stuff.
Well, yeah, because Quit Playing Games, what was so funny about that was that...
That was a map. That put us on the map right there.
We got it going on, came and went. And then we redid it again for the first single, which was Quit Playing Games, which was the world-renowned Rain video, which all of our fans know about us and our pastel shirts and our abs out.
And Howie's nipples.
Freaking Nipplegate.
Yours too, Kevin.
Nipplegate.
Oh, Howie. Yes.
Yes. Howie's nipples.
You had the close-up.
What I thought was awesome is that, you know, to go from Quit Playing Games to then Backstreet's Back, you know, we were all massive fans of Michael Jackson, all massive fans growing up of the Thriller video. We wanted to do something in that vein, which, again, is why it was a three-day video shoot. We were all in extensive makeup. They built the set from the ground up. What's crazy for me on a personal level is my brother-in-law now was a key grip on the Backstreet's Back video shoot.
What?
This goes back before I ever met my wife, clearly. So it's interesting how it comes around full circle however many years later. So that's pretty crazy to think about.
Man, I learned something new today on All I Have to Give Radio.
And my father-in-law was the key grip on Show Me the Meaning video before I met my wife. My wife's family's, they're all in the business. Like, they're all actors.
They were watching you for a while.
They were testing me out, basically. They were like, he seems okay, but he slipped up. Never mind. Moving on. So from Backstreet's Back, you know what? When you guys were talking about Turbo and all that stuff, it kind of made me start thinking about Prince B and those guys from PM Dawn, God rest his soul.
Ooh, yeah.
But a song called Set Adrift, which was cool. So that would be my personal favorite off that record.
Back at our old catalog and when we started out, If You Stay, which was produced by Prince B from PM Dawn, written and produced by him, we recorded that in London, England, while we were over there, I believe, on the one of those tours we did, Smash Hits tour. While we were on one of those breaks in the UK, we recorded that song. And again, this is before we broke in the U.S. We were just kicking off in Europe and the GAS territories. And Jive's like, hey, there's a soundtrack opportunity. Prince B from PM Don. That was the first time we'd ever worked with him. Obviously, we knew who he was, and God rest his soul, and we wanted to work with him. And to me, to this day, that's one of my favorite Backstreet catalog songs that we've ever done. It's got the Get Money sample in it, which I, to prepare for today, I looked up the original sample from that. Is from You Can't Turn Me Away. That was the name of the original sample that Big E and Junior Mafia got that sample from.
Hey, Kev, how old is that song? The original one that you're talking about.
You Can't Turn Me Away?
Yeah.
Shoot. I don't know.
I'm going to Google it.
Search it on the web right now on my iPhone.
Nick's going to get it.
But You Can't Turn Me Away, Get Money sample. But anyway,
okay. It's
If You Stay, Booty Call soundtrack, BSB. And everybody had no clue in the U.S. who we were, and it was getting airplay at R&B, hardcore R&B hip-hop stations.
You can just call me the fact-checker. Seriously, this is going to be my role in this show. I will Google everything and make sure that we're not, you know, that things are straight, all right?
You're the executive producer.
Sylvia Striplin, right, Kevin? Give Me Your Love. The album, and it looks like 1981.
Wow, it's not as old as I thought it was.
That's 81. About, wait, what year were you born, Nick?
1980.
I was going to say, you were like, diapers.
Nick was 1 year old.
Yeah, so it's 39 years old. Do the math, Nick.
Fast forward to the Millennium album, arguably our best-selling album of all time. I believe we're over 30 million units on that album alone. I just remember just before that album came out, we had a lot of turmoil in our life. A longtime management team, security team, a lot of people in our lives went another way.
True.
We went another way. That was the first time the five of us really had to just, for a time, it was just AJ's mom.
True.
Like doing the day-to-day, putting the schedules together. The five of us had to come together and really count on one another and one another alone. And that's where I think we, you know, they say, adversity reveals character. It doesn't build character. And we all stuck together and made arguably our best album to date, our greatest album that we've ever done.
Kevin, come on, man. That's one of the best albums in pop history. I'll say it. I think it was. Millennium was one of the best albums in pop history. I mean, come on, guys. Listen, I'm not saying that being an egomaniac. I'm not. Like, you just look for song for song and what we did. You know, that was a movement in time, man. People needed happy music, and it was a perfect setup. It was really a perfect setup for what we did. And we were on the blessing end of that, along with our fans. So that's the only reason I say it.
You know, you're right. It did come at the right time. I mean, the world was about to go into this Y2K, remember? Like, computers
which
were
never supposed happened.
To, yeah.
Which never happened. But it was supposed to shut down, and you know, I think things were just really in a good place. Musically was sort of a reflection of what was happening, you know, in society at the time. And we were an example of that, and it kind of just, it came out in our music at that time. And, you know, so we were happy, the world was happy, people were happy, and each song that we recorded at that time, I mean, even if you listen to one of our songs, I'll Be the One, which we sometimes look back and we're like, oh, really, people really like that song? But it was because it was a happy song, and again, it kind of came out in our music at that time.
And it's cool, I still get writer's royalties off of that, because I wrote a little bit of it, you know what I'm saying?
I ain't trying to get right no publishing today, y'all. I'm just playing. But I just wanted to finish the point of there was a lot of adversity in the beginning of making that album. All the way through, we had the album in the can, and we were still looking for the right management team. I'd say 50 to 70% of the album done when we were searching for management. If you remember, that's when our past management team threatened to, we were in a lawsuit, where our touring equipment was being locked up periodically. It was just a tumultuous time in our life.
But Kevin, don't you think that that's why the music turned out the way that it did? Is because we did, because we had all this adversity happening around us, so then we had to kind of bind together and come together, and so we were closer than we were ever before, so then, you know what I'm saying? So then that helped?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we put our heart and soul in the vocals and in the individual writing that we did. And then, of course, Max and Dennis, that was the last album we made with Dennis Pop. And so I'm going to go with the song where we honor Dennis Pop in the music video. It was Show Me the Meaning.
Show me the meaning of being lonely.
All I Have to Give Radio with the Backstreet Boys on Apple Music Hits.
And we've always been very open and honest to all of our fans out there. The good and the bad that we've gone through. And that, I think, is part of the reason why, if I recall correctly, why we came up with the title of the next album to be Black and Blue. Because we were going through a trying time. I'll never forget when Brian said, "What about Black and Blue?" And I remember us all going, yeah, that's kind of like how we felt at that time. Even though we had had a lot of success and we were still on the height of our career, internally, we felt like there were still a lot of things that weren't 100% settled with us and our where we were going, our direction, where we were at, you know, seeing eye to eye with the label, with management, all different things. And I just remember that probably is a good lead into, like I say, Black and Blue album. We had a lot of great songs off that record. I don't know if you guys remember the Call. The video for The Call was amazing. Get Another Boyfriend, Shape of My Heart. We had some really great videos that came out of that album.
It's funny that you say, because, you know, people think, okay, Black and Blue, when we would tell people or we talk about, it was a darker time. Surprisingly, dark or not, there's a lot of great songs on that record. Like, song for song, like, some really great songs. I mean, songs that we still put in the show today, you know? So it's like, one thing I'll just say about every album that we've done, and I kind of feel like this has been kind of par for the course, is we seem to learn something new every cycle, and it helps us grow in whatever way that it's meant to, whether it's musically, whether it's lyrically, whether it's physically, spiritual path, not the psychopath, crazy anymore, like whatever it is, it's like, it's awesome.
You took the words right out of my mouth, because what I was going to say is, you, when you go from Millennium to Black and Blue, you know, Millennium being like a massive smash for us, I think it gave us the courage to come out with Black and Blue, to not be afraid. You know what I'm saying? Because I think Millennium's gave us our, it almost gave us our stripes, you know, because Millennium was supposed to be the sophomore slump. You know, we didn't have that. In my personal opinion, and I think I could speak on behalf of us, is that it did give us the courage to say what we wanted to say in Black and Blue and not be fearful of that. Like, we kind of earned our stripes in that. And yes, it was a little darker, but you have to go back to the song material. And that song material was top-notch still. You know, it just had a little darker vibe to it. You know, the photo shoots, all that stuff.
Brian, I think the thing that made it hard was, and Kevin likes to speak about this, you know, coming out of Millennium, you know, we had just come out of this massive tour, one of our best shows ever, and we were tired. And you have managers, you know, changing of managers, record labels, people who wanted to monetize off of our success, and they wanted to capitalize off of it. And I remember that being an issue for us. So trying to keep the integrity of the music and what we were doing at the same time as taking care of our health was the problem. That was the dilemma.
Yeah, super tough.
But you have to look at, like, I think if you look at the cycle that happened from Black and Blue, obviously everybody knows that's when I went to treatment for the first time. There was a lot of things that came out of that. We ended up rising to the occasion after that, but like a lot of people didn't really, you know, realize, I think personally, after Black and Blue, that was the make it or break it point for us. Like, do we continue going or are we done? like we were burnt out. Obviously, I took it to the nth degree, but like to me, that was the most pivotal point of our career that could have went one way or the other way.
And you know? Right in the middle of the tour, 9/11 happened.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a black
so
and blue
many things.
Tour and album. That's so true how it all came in full circle around that.
Yeah, yeah.
I know we've been blessed with so many, what now, almost 10 records, so I know we don't have a lot of time, we probably need to get on some other records, so I'll make it quick and short. I'll go ahead and pick the song for this album here, and since we went off the grid with If You Stay, I'm going to be a little selfish here, because I've always thought this song was so cool, and I'm still going to pitch for it for one day for us to be on the Special Olympics. This song, What Makes You Different Makes You Beautiful, which I'm glad at least to remember. I don't know if you guys remember, but one really cool thing that came out of that song was it was on the soundtrack for The Princess Diary, the first one. And a couple of us went out and did the video shoot for that, and I'm very proud of that song.
It is a pretty song.
Get some publishing, Howie. Get some publishing.
Yeah, I'm trying. You know, I learned from you.
That's what I'm saying.
This is All I Have to Give Radio with the Backstreet Boys.
Okay, you're listening to All I Have to Give Radio. We've got Nick Carter, we've got AJ McLean, we've got Howard Duro, we've got Kevin Richardson, and I being Brian Littrell, and we are the Voltron that make up the
Backstreet Boys!
Hey! We are going through chronological order of our career. It's going to take forever. We're going to need 15,000 episodes, but that's okay. We've gone from Backstreet Boys to Backstreet's Back to Millennium to Black and Blue. And let's move on to Never Gone, okay? If I recall the years, I think Black and Blue came out in 2001, correct?
I know we ended that album cycle in like 01, 02. We ended the
yes.
tour.
I looked it up today. 2000. Okay, that's right. So we
greatest hits.
So
greatest
okay, hit. Now we're gonna go from 2000 to 2005. Okay, Never
yep.
Gone came yep. out in 2005, and when we got back together, which we never stopped because we were touring,
never
touring,
gone.
Touring. Yeah, we were never gone. So the cool thing is everybody wherever we went, people would be like, "Oh my gosh, you're so and so from the Backstreet Boys. Did you guys? What are you doing now? Did you stop?" And we were like, "No, no, no. We took a little break." And when I say a little break, I mean like 6 months, maybe. Did we take maybe 6 months?
I don't know. The tour ended in 2002, and we dropped an album in 2005. So we took a little while.
I know, but what I'm saying is, I think at this time, I think Nick was doing some solo stuff.
Nick did a solo album.
And we were also periodically recording. We never really stopped. I would say maybe 6-8 months that, you know, we were probably mad as hell at each other, so we didn't even talk, right? How about that?
And it took us a while to make the record as well. It took us almost a year to make the record. I mean.
Oh, it was a good couple years.
Or a couple years, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Probably because it was my fault, you know.
Nick, what year did your solo album drop, Nick?
I think it was like 02 or something like that. I can't remember.
Yeah, it was definitely your fault.
And Brian, did you do your gospel album during that time?
No, that was 2006.
Okay.
That was 4 years later. Let's stay on track. So we're at Never Gone, okay? Year is 2005. The really cool thing about this was the first record that we had ever done. I remember going to the studio. We were cutting some demos in L.A., and I took some cigars to the studio. And we started recording. I walked in, and I said, "Hey, guys, check this out." And I opened up the cigars, and I'll never forget, you know, you guys looking at me, Kevin's getting all teary-eyed, like, "Holy crap." And I said, "Yeah, I'm going to be a dad." So that was the first album that I became a dad. You know, so the experience for my life literally was, I mean, it was upside down. It had completely turned upside down. And I mean that for a good reason, because I feel like I became a man, I became a father, I become somebody that I always wanted to become. And, you know, that's, as a little boy, that's what I wanted to do when I grew up, was have a wife, have a family, and so I was getting all of my life. So
We're going to go to Never Gone 2005, and I've got some bangers off of that record that are special to me, and I think they're special to everybody, but I'm going to end on, I think, one of the best ones that's on that album that really didn't get, you know, its due, I think. I'm going to start with Climbing the Walls. You guys remember Climbing the Walls?
Yep.
It was written for the original Spider-Man soundtrack. Correct?
That's right.
And,
yes,
and
it
then
was.
it didn't get chosen. So listen, again, we're on All I Have to Give Radio, Apple Music, and you're hearing some updates from Backstreet Boys, because this is our world. We're sharing some personal stories that nobody knows. So Climbing the Walls was originally for the Spider-Man soundtrack.
I think a lot of people don't realize at that point music was changing.
Had changed, yeah. There was a pop backlash.
It had changed, and we had come back, and we really had a lot. We had no identity at that time. The label didn't know what they wanted us to be or we wanted to be, and everyone was just like, what is going on? So we go back to Max Martin. Max Martin at that time was starting to go back into sort of the things that he was influenced in and like when he was younger, which was rock music. And, you know, a lot of people don't realize he was a metalhead, you know, and he wrote metal music. He's very talented, but he was passionate about metal. So he, at that time, had just come off of writing stuff for Bon Jovi, It's My Life, if you remember.
Yep.
Just come out.
Yep.
And so that kind of inspired him to go in this new direction. So when we came back to him, he had already been writing all these songs that he was trying to reinvent himself with. You know, I remember the Kelly Clarkson song, Since You've Been Gone.
Since You've Been Gone.
One of the things that had come out of that era. And so we were just like, well, hey, you know, why don't we try something new as well? I mean, we love rock music. We love it. We want to just sing in general. And so I remember Climbing the Walls. The reason why that song was so special, because I'm a huge metal and rock fan as well, was that it was written for Chris Cornell.
Yeah, I was going to say, wasn't it written for somebody else first?
And if you go back and listen to it, you could hear, like, how he, Max, had
I would love to have heard him on that.
Yeah, it was really cool. Yeah.
That whole album was like a big departure for us because it was a lot more organic. It was a lot more of the rock sound, the acoustic stuff. Like, it was definitely not your typical type.
Yeah. Which,
do you remember though? Before that came out though, guys, we had almost a whole album in the can with the Underdogs that was straight. R&B.
It was so good.
Oh my gosh, that's right.
Someday we'll release to Apple Music.
We recorded that. No joke, guys. It was like over 2 years of recording. I think that was like one of the most amount of songs I think we've ever recorded for a record was that one. That was like over like 60, 70 songs.
Because we didn't make up our mind at that time.
Yeah. We were still searching for our identity, like you said.
It was heavily gospel and R&B. Who are the gospel producers we were with?
You used to be the one I'd fight for.
Oh, that was the Jam. Pajam. The gospel producer.
So I'm going to go back to when I talk about April 20th, the first day I met you guys, 1993. The reason that I'm here right now is because of my cousin Kevin. Okay, and I'm not going to get sentimental, but this is a cool time, right? This is what we get to share in, our joy, our hard work. We busted our asses to get where we're at today. And I'm thankful for you guys. And so I'm going to pick Never Gone, the title track. Was written by Kevin, you know, co-produced by Kevin. It was about his dad, my uncle, that we no longer have. You know, these are things that as artists, you want to be able to share the sentimental side. You don't want to be afraid to do that. And for Kevin, you know, somebody like Kevin is, he's a hard guy. And he has trouble kind of sharing. I'm not speaking for you, Kevin, but kind of. And that's the thing, you know. You know,
Kevin's got a soft heart.
Yeah, he does. He has a soft heart, but he has a stiff, you know, demeanor. And for him to come out with this song and to feel free to write it and to be able to share it with the world, like, this is what the listeners need to know. It's like, when we cut something, when it's in the studio, it's on a microphone, and it's just embedded into everybody's soul at that one time. Like, it never goes away. it's you'll always be able to find these songs. And this is what's really cool about music history in our place. And with All I Have to Give Radio, it's something that we're going to enjoy hopefully for a long, long time. So I'm going to go back to the Never Gone record. Came out in 2005, the title track. This is my favorite, Never Gone.
The things we did, the things we said, keep coming back to me and make me smile again. You sure are gone, never far. In my heart is where you are.
All right, guys, we are back with All I Have to Give Radio on Apple Music. We've got Nick Carter, AJ McLean, Kevin Richardson,
hey.
Howard Duroe, and Brian Littrell.
That's you.
And we are the Backstreet Boys. Oh, my gosh.
We're back again.
Hey, so we've been talking about our entire career. This has been a great first episode, I will say. Right? Have you guys enjoyed it?
Yes.
Yep.
Always wanted to have my own radio station.
Yeah, listen, so if we can't be on tour, since we left, you know, we were in South America last together. We were in South America on
tour.
Where
did we play last, Brian?
We played in Brazil.
Yeah. Rio.
Rio.
Rio de Janeiro.
Yes.
To all the fans in Brazil, we did not get to play Sao Paulo, which was going to be the biggest show on the tour, like 45, 50,000 people.
Yeah.
50,
we are working
people.
On putting that show back together and playing a makeup show and maybe even doing a whole nother South American leg. But we just want y'all to know that. So we came from South America.
Yep.
And since then, we've all been in lockdown.
And if they listen to All I Have to Give Radio, they would know that. Right, Kevin?
Hallelujah.
Okay. So let's talk about the DNA World Tour, okay? You know, we did have to announce, unfortunately, that the dates from 2020, this summer, are moving to next summer,
2021.
Right? 2021. Yep. So let's talk about the DNA album and really what is the DNA of the Backstreet Boys. I think everybody's getting the gist from, as they listen to our history of, you know, we're all sharing our individual likes and dislikes of what we've done in the past. I'm going to go first with the DNA album, and I'm going to pick Chances, okay? Chances is one of my favorite songs on the DNA album. It was written by Ryan Tedder and...
Shawn Mendes.
Two pretty big names in the music business when you talk about writers as well as performers and singers. So this is Chances. It's one of my favorites. It's one of these, like, dark, deep places that you go and love. Where, at the end of the day, what are the chances that the Backstreet Boys would be here today on All I Have to Give Radio? Let's go.
What if I never run into you? What if you never smiled at me?
You know, a little FF fun fact, if you will. to all the fans and to all the listeners that may not know the backstory, the long and short of it is, we were in Las Vegas, in the middle of our Las Vegas residency, sitting in our little hospitality suite with our manager, Jen, and the five of us sitting, brainstorming, trying to think of concept for the album, possible album title, direction, and Kevin was the one that was kind of the catalyst for this, basically by talking about the fact that what makes up the Backstreet Boys sound is digital and analog. Digital sounds like Backstreet's Back and Larger Than Life and We Got It Going On, and then analog, more of the organic sounding songs like I Want It That Way and As Long As You Love Me and Shape of My Heart.
And then also, when we started recording, there was no digital. We recorded when we first started out
on tape, reel to reel
in the studio, take after take. So keep going. I just wanted to ask.
So that's analog. So I basically heard Kevin say that, and no disrespect to my other brothers, but they were all talking about whatever they were talking about, and I tuned you guys out for a second, and I went off into another world.
You do that all the time, AJ.
Like I normally do. Most creative people do that. And I'm like, DNA. DNA is a great name. And I threw it out, and you guys loved it, management loved it, and hence the name of the album, DNA.
And the fact that the five of us, which we've expressed through All I Have to Give Radio, have such varied taste in music.
Exactly.
True.
And our influences are all over the map. All over the map. Country, hip-hop, R&B, gospel, rock, everything in between, dance. Pop, dance. But when our five voices come together, we have a unique sound. We become one unique Voltron instrument.
It's kind of like the ending of the Trolls movie, Trolls 2.
Yes, it is. It is.
Wow.
It is.
But I will say, if I have to pick something off of the DNA album, I don't want to give anything away to anyone that hasn't seen the DNA World Tour yet. But
just say it, AJ. There's 32 songs in the set.
My song is Passionate. I love that record. That record was actually brought to us by our bandmate, Mr. Nick Carter. And Nick, who wrote that song? A buddy of yours, right?
Andy Grammer, baby.
That's right. AG.
Andy Grammer, like, incredible writer. As I was competing with him on Dance with the Stars, every time, you know, we would make it through another episode or another week, I'd always, like, give him little hints. I'm like, you know, you got to write a song for the Backstreet Boys, right? You know, and he'd be like, dude, I'm competing with you right now. Can you just, like, stop? You know, like, no, but, like, seriously, Andy, incredible writer. And I called him up and I'm like, dude, do you have anything? Like, let me know. He's like, yeah, I just wrote about 100 songs for my album. I might have
100. What? 100.
He had written like 100 songs. I'm like, well, could you like throw a bone maybe to the Backstreet Boys?
Yeah. So this is Passionate.
I'm the type of person to get carried away. Been this way since I can't.
Apple Music. You're listening to All I Have to Give Radio with the Backstreet Boys.
For the past year and a half, we've been living on the road and, you know, touring this album that we recorded, you know. And so I had, like, obviously I had certain songs that I had picked that I loved when we were in the studio recording, but then I kind of changed it a little bit when I got on the road and I was seeing how, you know, the crowds were responding to the certain songs. And one song that really just captured my heart, it's a moment in our show. We call it a gag routine. We go up on this thing. Sorry, you know, spoiler alert if you haven't seen the show.
We go up on the cherry picker lift.
We go up on this cherry picker lift, and, you know, we perform an acapella song, and it's called Breathe.
It was our first one. It set the bar that we were like, okay, we want to keep this song. We really like it. Everything else needs to be as good or above this song. But at first, it was just a piano song, and we were like, it needs percussion. It needs some kind of rhythm to it. And then the label suggested, why don't you guys do it a cappella? And
it's a magical song. You know, sometimes, like you said, things start out a certain way. And that's what creativity is all about. As being, you know, a lot of people like to say, okay, well, the Backstreet Boys are just dancers and singers. And, you know, there's a lot more that goes into things behind the scenes that we're involved with. And, you know, it's a very big creative process and, you know, bouncing things off each other. And that's the rewarding part about being an artist, you know, behind the scenes as well, you know, so.
True. Hey, sometimes you just got to stop and breathe. Right, Nick?
Exactly.
Still numb from you. You know, I got to say, this album, DNA, to me, definitely gave us a comeback. I feel like this is the record that put us back on the map, and I think one of the biggest reasons was because of the first single that came out, Don't Go Breaking My Heart, which I'm so proud to say that we got honored once again to be nominated for a Grammy with that song. We had some amazing writers that wrote that song. Stuart Crichton, is that how you say it, Kevin?
That's right, brother.
Yep.
Stuart Crichton.
And the artist Rabel.
Rabel, that's right. And I feel like Stuart really came to us, and I really feel like helped us to really find that direction. Once we got Don't Go Breaking My Heart, for sure, I think we knew we had the record solidified, that we were going in the right direction for sure at that point. And he came to the table with a couple other songs. One of my favorites, besides Don't Go Breaking My Heart, which I'm going to introduce for you guys now, is one that he came to the table as well. It's a song called Chateau, and it's about a couple. But a guy that's lost his love with this person, but they've gone on their separate ways, but he just wants them to meet back at the chateau where it all began and rekindle that love. So
the famous hotel on the Sunset Strip.
That's right. That's right.
We made some memories back in the day, boys. Wait. Can we remember this? Let's all take a journey back. We were getting ready to receive our first award in the United States for sales, and we had a party, an album release party, and an award ceremony with our label, Sonia Muckle, Barry Wise, Jeff Fenster, and then Hugh Hefner shows up with the Playboy bunnies, and it was at the Chateau in Los Angeles. Yeah. I just wanted to recall that memory in your brain.
That was.
The Playboy just keeps coming up.
It's funny.
In this, All I Have to Give Radio.
You're thinking we're a bunch of horny dogs.
Well, we were a bunch of young men.
Yes, that is true. That is true. We're here for you guys. On that note, is Chateau.
I saw you on the corner. You look happy. Happier than
I want you back.
All I Have to Give Radio
with the Backstreet Boys
on Apple Music Hits.
All right, so we're talking about songs off of the DNA album, and like Howie alluded to earlier, DNA, this whole thing that happened with us getting nominated for our 8th Grammy Award, and having our 9th or 10th top 5 album on the Billboard charts when it came out. Wait, our song was number one, right? I mean, our album was number one, right?
Album was number one.
Album was number one.
Yeah. So, and that's the 9th or the 10th Backstreet Boys album that has entered Billboard's Hot 100 in the top 10.
I think it's our 10th, yes.
10th.
It's our 10th.
Which on the last tour, the In a World Like This tour, we were in good company with Led Zeppelin and Sade.
Sade.
With 9. And now we're at 10, so somebody's going to have to Google that and see where we are statistically speaking with that. But this album was like a renaissance for us. I think Las Vegas, the residency that we did there reinvigorated. It almost made me feel like I was 25 again. you know, being a father of two boys, it was kind of a beautiful thing to go to Vegas on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and then come home and be a dad with my boys Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. And then my wife would come out to Vegas on, you know, Friday night and Saturday night, and we would entertain our friends. They would come to the
party
show.
Party at the Chateau.
We had a party at the Chateau. There's the Chateau again. And so it reinvigorated us, and I think inspired us and gave us a little bit of bravado again, you know, like made us feel like, I'm not as old as I think I am, when really I was.
Until the next morning.
But I have a lot of favorite songs on this record. I bring up bravado because I feel like Passionate and New Love, like if you think back to some of our earlier songs, We Got It Going On, Backstreet's Back, The Call, the lyrics, you know, as artists, you're not literal a lot of the time. Sometimes you fantasize about you want to be a superhero or you want to be a super lover or whatever. And so I feel like Passionate and New Love had that bravado from the old days that made me feel like, hey, as a, you know, 40-something, I can still be sexy.
Yeah,
40-something. I like that.
So I'm conflicted because I want everybody to hear Don't Go Breaking My Heart, but I also want them to bump New Love because that song is,
It's fire.
I love that bass line, and it makes me feel like just, I don't know, it brings it back. So here's a little New Love for you off of DNA.
Oh, yeah.
We are back on All I Have to Give Radio, Apple Music. This is episode 1. We are wrapping it up. Are we not, gentlemen?
Hallelujah.
That's a wrap.
Yeah, baby.
Stick a fork in it.
Listen.
listen, I just want to thank everybody for listening on behalf of BSB. You know, going from Backstreet Boys original in 1993 to DNA, you know, a couple years ago in the world tour, and still music to come from the Backstreet Boys. We just want to thank you guys for listening to our influences. Thank you for allowing us to be the artists that we are today. Thank you for also inspiring us and giving us love and joy when we see the smiling faces when we're on the stage performing. That's what we need. And we're looking forward to getting back in front of you all's faces and having parties like never before. And again, any and all news Backstreet Boys wise, please, please join the Apple family. Get on Apple Music and click on All I Have to Give Radio. And who knows what you might find. So thank you guys, and stay tuned, stay well, be strong, and be safe. And God bless, and gotta go. See ya.
Peace out.
Deuces.
Love, baby.
See you next episode.
See ya. I got mixed emotions. Did I?